That skit, obviously, in not too subtle fashion, introduces us to the point that when you are a fiduciary, let's say you're an agent for someone, you are supposed to act like an angel. And we tried to beat that home with that skit. I'm trying to remind you of it, I suppose, with the countervailing view, which is you should not be a devil or a devil's agent, hence the silly hat here. But it's a point that one should never overlook, and that is, if in doubt, do whatever you think is necessary to secure the interests of the person for whom you are acting. You are not supposed to be looking after your own interests first, and it's not even supposed to be an equal position. You are supposed to be first and foremost looking after the interest of the other side. If you can't do that, don't enter into this relationship. If you can't continue to do this, then exit out of the relationship. If there is a problem with information, disclose, disclose, disclose. Let the other party know so it can make an informed judgment as to what you should do. Maybe it'll decide it doesn't matter. You can go ahead in your position, even though there are some conflicts. Or maybe it will decide you should no longer continue as a fiduciary. That's fine. What gets people in trouble is when they fail to disclose inconsistencies or conflicts of interest, when they proceed nonetheless in areas where it may be self-serving, and only after the fact does a party find out and determine, hey, you really weren't doing what was in my best interests. And of course, it's a lot easier for them to make that assumption if they find out that you were doing things that served yourself. Give them that information up front, they can make an informed judgment, and after the fact, they can't really squeal too much about it if it doesn't turn out to be such a great deal for them because they knew what the risks were. Now, as a reminder of what fiduciaryship and owing these duties is all about, let me tell you a little story. And the story goes as follows. There were three dear friends of a dying man. These three dear friends were a minister, a doctor, and a lawyer. Now, the dying man was an experimental kind of guy, so he called them all into his bedroom, and there, as sort of a dying declaration, he told them that he wanted one last grand experiment. He wanted to test the proposition, you can't take it with you. He wanted to see whether you actually can take it with you. What he said was, you know, I got a lot of money. I'm going to give a fair amount to charity and relatives and others, but I've got so much to play with, I want to experiment with some of this money. Here is $30,000 apiece. And he gave each one of them $30,000 in cash. He said to them, I'm a dying. They all said, oh, no, no, no. He said, no, I am. I'm dying. I want you, when they lay me low in the ground, I want you to open the coffin and just slide the $30,000 in there, and I'll see. I'll find out. I guess I can tell you later when you all join me. I'll find out whether, in fact, you can take it with you. So the friends all swore that that's what they would do. A few weeks later, on the way back from the funeral, the three friends were in a car together, leaving. And the minister blurts out. He says, I can't take it anymore. I have a confession to make. People usually confess to me, but now I have a confession to make. I did not put the full $30,000 into the coffin. I took $10,000 of the $30,000. And as you may know, our friend was a member of the congregation in good standing. He knew we had needs. And I don't think he would have disapproved of what I'd done. I took some of the money and had some necessary repairs performed on the church building. Necessary repairs, things that he would have approved of. I've got a small plaque there dedicated to him and to his beneficial use of the money. And the rest of the money, the remaining $20,000, I put into the coffin. The doctor said, well, as long as you're coming clean, I have a confession to make as well. As you may know, my friend, our friend, died of a loathed disease, which if only we had been able to detect it earlier, perhaps we could have saved him. We didn't have the necessary equipment. It's very, very expensive equipment. And so what I did was I took $20,000 of the $30,000 and bought the equipment. I've now got it here in the town clinic. It's available for anyone to use in the medical profession so that we can determine early on the onset of this loathed disease, and we may spare others the grisly fate that befell our friend. And I took the remaining $10,000 of the $30,000 in cash, and I slid that into the coffin. The lawyer looked at the minister and the doctor with loathing, with disgust. How dare you? How dare you violate your fiduciary duties? Our dying friend's last request, his very last request to us, a simple request, was that we put in the coffin the $30,000 that he entrusted to us. That was his prime request, and you broke it. I'll have you know, I put the full $30,000 into the coffin in the form of my personal check. Now think about that. Think about that. Technically, the lawyer is right. Technically, he's the only one who obeyed the fiduciary duty in the sense of he put a $30,000 amount in there. But he put a check in there. One could imagine the surprise if the lawyer ever looks through a bank statement and sees that somehow the check is cleared. Presumably, the check will never be deposited, never cleared, and the lawyer has kept $30,000 in cash, probably for his own use. And so technically, the lawyer is correct. But in the broader scheme of things, I would argue that it is the lawyer who is most in violation of the fiduciary duty owed to the decedent. The lawyer is overlooking the spirit of the request. The spirit of the request was this grand experiment. The spirit of the request was not to put a check in there, but to put cash in there, cold cash in there. The spirit of the request was such that I think a doctor or a minister or some other such friend could come up with at least a rationale for why this usage of the money on something other than the minister or doctor's own self-interest, spending it on the church, spending it on the clinic and equipment for detecting a disease, that usage, while not really requested by the decedent, at least is in line with something the decedent might have approved of. And then putting the rest of the money in is a sign of good faith that you weren't trying to take advantage of the decedent. Whereas the lawyer, clearly by the clever approach of writing out a check and keeping the cash, has, I think, violated the spirit of the request. I like to tell this story for two reasons. One, I think it's a spiffy little story, but two, it's because it really does tie in with the concept of fiduciary duties, and the notion here should be clear, and that is, if in doubt, do what most people looking at the thing from an objective point of view would say, yes, you're doing the right thing, you're looking after the interest of the other person, you're behaving within the spirit of the fiduciary relationship, within the spirit of what that person who is dependent upon you would have expected. That's the test we should take. Always act in the best interest of the principal. If you as an agent can't do that, then by golly, don't be an agent.